I operate in the enterprise space, so I am actually doing 3 or 4 sessions, sort of putting together the sessions, which we 9 months sale process, enterprise sales, and we have Shankar from Subex, who's going to moderate this session, and I wanted to get him on board, and then he'll take it up from here. Over to you, Shankar.
Thank you, Suresh. Well, good morning to everybody. We thought we were competing with the other sessions till somebody said we're competing with lunch. So, but we'll try and keep this engaging. We all heard the keynote yesterday by the key members of Nasscom, Sharath and others. They're aspiring about this 1 million or so many product companies doing 1 billion every year. And based on the audience and the number of companies we're seeing here, based on the energy and the enthusiasm, it looks pretty much possible. But to get to this 1 billion, you have to sell, right? Sales have to happen. And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about specifically complex sales. The reason I was asked to talk about this is they said a lot of these companies out there in India, which start off based on a brilliant innovative idea or based on a few relationships and a small project, and they have to scale beyond that. And that's when the real struggle starts, because you start competing with much larger names and much more complex kind of an engagement. So that's pretty much the focus audience we're going to talk about today. Small companies aspiring to be big, going after big ticket, how do you compete? Going to keep it simple, talk about the basics. And to help me on that, I have two panel members today. May I invite Anil? Anil used to be the head of sales for sales and marketing for Wipro for a long time. He was also instrumental in setting up IBM when they came back to India in the 1990s. He also set up the Sun Microsystems and headed the India and South Asia. Was it South Asia, Anand? South Asia for Sun Microsystems as the managing director. Involved in quite a few other companies like Birlasoft, and now focusing on micropayments. Microfinance, all right. And the second speaker we have is Ranjan Roy. Ranjan has got more than 18 plus years in sales, worked in all kinds of geographies spanning Europe, Middle East, Africa, also handled sales across multiple cultural barriers, which includes language, culture, so on and so forth. And he is now a freelance consultant and going to be sharing his experiences as well. He was also part of the team which was there when iFlex got transitioned to Oracle, and used to, in his last stint, head the marketing and sales for EMEA, right? And used to head a pretty strong team out there. Now, we spoke about these companies, right? So the companies start off small. They get there on the basis of a few relationships, and suddenly they start the struggle. And they realize at that point that whatever got them till that point of time is not enough to scale beyond that. They also realize that you can't rely on hope, you got to do something else. And then you come up with this beast called complex sales. And so what exactly is a complex sale? We could make it very complex, but our attempt today in the next 15 minutes is going to be try and make it as simple as possible, so that it's more to scare you guys, right? So typically these are what we are saying as characteristics which define what a complex sale is all about, right? Complex sale is all about a very long haul sale. It's not a sale where you go in and you say that you're going to have something's going to happen in a month or two. I mean, even though you may have come in there with your relationship, even in that context, you would have noticed that that sale would have taken you pretty much 6 months. So imagine going after a sale where you don't have any base. It's a pretty new opportunity. You've been there from the start, and it's going to take a fair amount of time. And obviously, you've got people to answer, right? So you've got to plan as a company to figure out whether it's an opportunity you are able to compete. You are able to put in all your resources for such a long period of time, right? Complex sales also involve multiple decision makers. Now, typically what tends to happen is when you start engaging in an opportunity, you tend to work with a few individuals, and As human beings, our tendency is to go into a comfort zone, which is talk to the operational level guys, talk to the people we are comfortable with, and believe that he is the man who's going to make the deal for us. But unfortunately, that's not true. There are many people there who are involved in a deal of that nature. It's not one person. It's, I mean, talking about our own experiences, we have been engaged. We typically believe that the sale happens to the CFO in our SUBEX kind of a context. But we realize that it's not the CFO alone, but we also have to go and talk to the IT, because he has to approve whether we are compliant to their security standards. Because if we don't do that, the competition may very well have used that to kick us out of the deal and say, you know, these guys are out of the deal. They may be technically an excellent product, but if I don't cover that guy, I'm history soon. High value. I mean, we're not talking about the B2C kind of a deal here. We're talking about more of the B2B high value deals. It's long haul, high value, multiple competition. Again, it's not competition just against another existing incumbent vendor, but you would have multiple stakeholders or multiple people coming in with multiple ideas saying, I prefer this company, this one's the best of breed in this particular category. And mind you, there is also the option for the prospect to not do anything. That also is a competition for you. So you have to pretty much consider all these as options that one will have to consider when they're coming up with a plan to compete and win on that particular opportunity. And the last is, you need to have a clearly defined evaluation, or rather, the opportunity will have a clearly defined evaluation process. As much as we believe that it's one individual or two, three individuals who are going to make the decision, as you talk about institutional buying, there is clearly defined process saying each procurement or purchase has to go through these steps. So these people have to approve, the budget has to be there, right? And it is important for us to be aware of all these parameters. Now, another key point in a complex sale is you need to be sure that there is a clearly defined requirement. I mean, you don't want to go after something which the customer is saying, I would like to have, but the fundamental premise is that there is a clearly defined need, and then all these are part of that particular scenario, right? Why am I talking about this? I'm talking about this basically because as you start competing in a large sale, you need to be aware that these are the parameters. You need to recognize, you need to prepare, you need to plan, right? And we're going to share more in terms of experiences and how we dealt with that. The other transition which typically has to happen in product companies is there are multiple parameters in a sale. There is a product. Typically, that's where most of us get stuck. And we are no exception as well, right? We do that at times. We believe we have the best product and therefore it will sell. But that's not good enough. You need to look at what does it take for the customer as an entire requirement. Is it the product alone? Is it a service? How are you going to deliver it? Are you selling it as a product with an SI, with a partner? Are you going to go in with a complete solution and say, I'm going to do a build-own transfer or a build-own operate transfer? You also need to be cognizant of the customer's environment. Right? You need to know what the customer's environment like. What are his requirements? What are his expectations? What exactly is the pain area that we are addressing? I mean, you could be going and selling something which may be completely irrelevant to the need. If you're lucky, it goes through. Otherwise, it might get shot at the first given opportunity into the next budget cycle. And competition. You can't afford to ignore competition. Typically, again, you tend to believe on these relationships and say that, I know this guy, he's my man inside, he's my coach, and he's going to help me get the deal. You believe that the competition can be managed, but only to realize that after you have influenced the RFP, right, you worked on the customer, you defined the requirements, you spec'd it out very well, laid it all done, and the competition has been silently observing. They come back and say, somebody at the CXO level, we go in, have a business meeting, or they play golf, and that's it. You know that the deal is gone, right? You forecasted that, you said the deal is coming, and next week you realize that you're not even in the race. Please don't ignore competition. And in a complex sale, it's important that we look at all these parameters. consciously and make an effort to address each of these. You may not have the solutions at all points of time, but at least it's necessary to be aware. And again, when you talk about the different stages in a sales cycle, you talk about prospecting, you talk about, once you put the proposal, you're talking about account management, you're talking about creating the proposal as well, and finally you're talking about selling the whole thing, not necessarily as a product. And at each stage, the tendency is, at a prospecting stage, you rely on relationships. Now, a relationship alone may not necessarily get you the deal, right? I mean, it might pretty much be as well. So what used to happen in our case is, when we used to go after smaller markets, it would be easier for us in the emerging markets to get access to the CXOs. And what we were therefore doing was building relationships with the CXOs, who were also the person who was owning the budget. He had the authority to go in and sign the check. And we had a relationship there. So we were solving the dual purpose of getting the deal done, but also getting the guidance from him in terms of building that relationship into a transaction. But imagine you had that relationship with somebody at the manager level. And typically these are people who would love to say they are the decision makers, right? And we have to look out for these people. They're always trying to stop you from the deal, and you would get yourself into a fix saying, what happens if I go beyond this guy? He's going to be annoyed, he's going to go against me, right? So you again have to tackle some of this and say, use him to take you along with him and say, it's going to help you in the whole process. What is his involvement? Can you give him a role to play in the whole transaction so that he is motivated to take you along, right? In the proposal stage, talking about technical superiority again, that's something which we all do pretty well, right? Specifically product companies. We love our products. We are passionate about them. We know them inside out. At the drop of a hat, even if somebody wakes you up in your dream, you're willing to talk about your products. Everybody knows about the features, functionality. So the passion is there, and that gets captured in the proposal, right? But are we able to say that that alone is going to get us the deal? Not really, right? And individual credibility. So it's either one person in the organization who has the credibility, who's trying to sell on the basis of that individual credibility, or you are relying on one head of a department and saying you are the head of the department, therefore you will make it happen. These are all pitfalls which will typically happen in a complex sale, right? Account management, again, you are guided by the influence that one person has within the organization. And we typically tend to confuse individuals with owning the power. To make it simple, the power that an individual or a stakeholder has on the opportunity is a factor of their influence and involvement in the deal, right? So if he is not able to influence the deal, then his power is pretty much zero, whatever he says. And you have to validate that by asking questions saying, so do you know what happens to this? Is he sharing information with you about something which is forthcoming? Who are the companies which are competing with? Is he willing to share information with you? Is he helping you create and define the value proposition, right? So you have to find that individual at all points of time for every opportunity. It's very important to have a coach. So for every opportunity, you have to go in, find a coach and say, this guy is the guy who's going to help me navigate through the whole deal, right? So always try and groom or identify and build upon a coach for each of your opportunities. And more importantly, as you start engaging in a large deal, you have to start moving away from a product focus. You have to sell it as a solution. And in a solution context, you start focusing on the business need. So you have to spend a lot of time trying to understand what the customer's problem is all about, right? So for example, in Subex, as you all know, is the global leader in fraud prevention systems. And typically, we go in with going to any of the greenfield, which is all the new licenses. And the positioning there is that if you don't have a system in place when you launch your services, then the whole fraudsters are going to come from the network onto your network, right? So that is the value proposition. But I can't take the same one to an existing telco there, right? So for an existing telco, the value proposition will be very different. I will talk about the impact it will have on its bottom line and top line and so on and so forth. I will talk about profitability, right? I will talk about better utilization of their network capacity. So the value proposition also changes depending on who you're dealing with and the context and the exact stage at which that customer is at that point of time, right? So again, this is when you rely on relationships, this is pretty much what happens. You end up with a business with a very good story, but the light is pretty much non-existent at the end of the tunnel because you already leveraged on those relationships and not able to scale beyond, right? So with that, Anil, if you could probably share a bit of your experiences.
I don't know about all of you, but I thought yesterday's sessions were really totally outstanding. You know, we had these great sessions with Vinod Khosla. I enjoyed that tremendously. Brad Smith, Mahesh Murthy, totally outstanding. And it's so inspiring, and they give you a span of what entrepreneurship is, taking risk, what are the rules you should follow, and things of that type. But when you go back from this conference, you know, what are the nuts and bolts that, you know, coming down to earth, if I may say, you're going to face the issues that really a typical startup or a small organization faces, which is, you know, to see, keep the fires burning, get the money in, make the sale, and of course, make sure your delivery is there, people are hired, and things of that type. And clearly, you know, one of the most challenging is the issue of sales. Now, I'd just like to find out from this audience, you know, how many of you are entrepreneurs? Can you just put up your hands, please? Great, that's the last one. Now, I'm going to request those entrepreneurs who have, in this crowd, who have worked for an organization where the revenues are more than, let's say, $2 million. I'm surprised because that's quite a large number. Okay, can I ask anything more than $5 million? This number is quite small. So obviously, see, the size of a startup in India is substantially less than those that you get, let's say, from the US. So when you get a speaker from the US, he's talking about a different kind of startup. He's talking about 10, 20, 30, $50 million, or even $100 million is a startup. Whereas in our case, you know, Subex is of that size and is established. So most of the organizations that we have in the product conclave and the most of the people in the product ecosystem in India are organizations who have $1 million in revenue, half a million dollars revenue, $2 million, $3 million, $4 million, and that's about $8 and $5 million. So that's the kind of organization that we're really talking to. And when we talk about a larger deal, what size of deal are we talking about? Possibly $250,000, that I think you'd agree that's a large deal for most of us in this room. So what I would like to do, and you know, and obviously when you talk about a large deal, you know, that you're going to talk either to a large organization or you're talking to a smaller organization, a medium-sized organization, but a fairly large ticket. And why is it complex? Because an organization of that size has a structure, has processes, has divisions, has multiple businesses, and has matured over time, and you know, and you have to follow that. And since it's a large organization, you're not meeting the top man who decides, you're meeting various people. So the effort that I would make in the next few minutes is to talk about the actual practical steps that one would follow. If I was talking to, let's say, the regional managers in an IBM or something, I would talk very differently because then the issues that arise there are different. But in a startup, the issues are very different. And this is, of course, a complex sale is something that you have to crack. Many startups manage to get some traction, get some revenue through relationships without having very much of a sales process. But it's when you go to a larger organization, look for deals like this, that's when you mature. That's when, and you have to make that, cross that hurdle to be able to go to the next level. So let's see what that involves. The first thing, and I, you know, I do a lot of mentoring, I go to smaller organization startups, and I'm surprised repeatedly that very few of the organizations are clear on their value proposition. And I think that's the starting point. Frankly, that's not something that you should do only for a complex sale or for a large sale. It should be for any sale. You should be clear. What is the value you're going to bring to your customers? And all too often the focus is on the product or the technology or the elegance of that technology or the how great it is, rather than what it really means to the customer. Because somebody is going to pay money for it, and as you would all know, in life, it's very difficult to get people to part with their money. That's what you're doing in sales. And you must talk in a language, in terms that he can understand, relate to his business, and bring out the business benefits. You know, cost saving, a response time improvement, some inefficiency being removed, some revenue increase, and it must be something relevant to his business. And I think, you know, those are the kinds of issues that really make a difference between a product and a super technology or something very cool to something that will vibe with the customer. And it's important to do that, because when you interact with the customer, whether you do it on the net or you do it on the phone or you do it in person, you have to get the customer's attention, especially when you're talking about a large organization. A lot of people are going to be coming to meet him, especially if he's a senior person, and you must get his attention early. And you will get his attention if you say, my offering can save you this kind of money, can get you this kind of benefit, or can increase your revenue in this period of time. You must talk in money terms, ideally, or in terms that the issues that he faces in his business all the time. So that's the starting point. If you might, for a simpler sale, get by without being very clear on it, talking about your technology. You get somebody who's hung up on technology, understands it, appreciates how cool it is. But if you go to a large organization, they do a very logical, reasoned sale. You have to articulate your value proposition. The second thing that I think is very important indeed is qualification. Now, that's a term that has been used throughout yesterday and, you know, other conferences you've attended. But what exactly is qualification? Basically, it is deciding, should my company, my organization, go after this opportunity? Why? It's a big name, you should go after it. It's a big ticket deal. But you have limited resources. Sales capabilities or sales bandwidth in most startups is relatively small. Typically, startups are started by people who are technically very good, who have been technologists, and their weakness is more in the sales and marketing area. And that's what needs to be conserved. And when you go into selling a big ticket sale or a large organization, the problem is that a lot of resources are going to be required. Now, you can start chasing all the large names. You get some lead, and you can chase 20 deals. And at the end of it, you may end up with nothing. And in sales, unfortunately, it's winner take all. If you have spent months going after that account, you spent a lot of time, travel, expense, energy, and you lost the deal, you get nothing out of it. So you have to conserve your resources and direct them and use them in areas where you, certain things should be met. And let's see, what are those things that you look for in qualification? First and foremost, is you must ask yourself the question, can we win this deal? Can I get this business? Because that's the starting point. If you think that it's a very it's very tough to do that. There's a vendor qualification process. He's only looking at large organizations. He's looking at people with a track record in that. You may not have a track record with other similar cases like this, things like that. Then it's better to avoid that and avoid wasting that effort and use that limited bandwidth somewhere else. Another question that you need to ask yourself is my product or offering or solution meeting his need? What is his need? And does it meet his need? If it does, can I deliver? Do I have the resources to deliver that? He has a certain expectation. Do you meet his expectations? You know, these are the sorts of questions that you must answer when you're qualifying the account before you really commit the organization's resources to marketing or trying going after that deal. And then after the sale, there's going to be a continuing involvement. Your product or your service based on a product or whatever is being used over a period of time. Support is definitely going to be required. Upgrades are going to be required and so on. Are you in a position to provide that kind of support? And you have to, of course, find out, is it going to give you a reference that you need? And at the end of the day, the question that you really have to ask yourself, can I make money? It sucks up all your organization's resources. You get to win the deal, and you lose money. Then what for? You're in business to make money. You might consciously decide that I will take this deal even if I'm going to lose money because I need this reference. But you should make a calculated decision that that's what I want to do. Not lose your shirt thinking that you're going to make money. So these are the kinds of questions that you must ask before you really commit resources. Don't go after 20 deals and get none. Go after 2 deals and get 1. Hopefully 2. And because this has to be done early in the cycle, don't leave it to a junior person. A lot of this involves judgment. So you must bring somebody who's seasoned, who's been in business. So senior level people have to be involved at the early stage. It's not just at the closing stages, but at the early stage to make that commitment of resources to a particular deal. Another thing that I find repeatedly in many smaller organizations is that they don't take the effort in understanding the customer's business. I ask them, you know, what is the size of this customer? What is his revenues? They have no idea. What is the main business of this organization, or what are the various businesses this organization is in? They don't know. What are the kinds of issues that industry or that business is going through today? What are the problems? Because those are the things that he's looking for solutions to. You're providing a solution, an answer to his problems. So you must understand what those problems are. You know, in telecom, the ARPUs are coming down. In something else, it is the need to increase revenues, the increase to reduce costs. Something, you must understand where the problem pain points are. Because then only can you talk in a language that is relevant to him, which resonates with him, and where he is going to give you a patient hearing. Various other things, what are his competitors? What is this position? And then I think one thing that we tend to forget is we may know something about the particular division we're working in, but very often a large organization will have multiple businesses, multiple divisions. Where does this business fit in the entire organization? You may go to GE, and this may be a big thing as far as you're concerned, but you know, GE is a huge organization. I remember once years ago I went to ITC, to their Infotech division. And you know, the man, for me, was an important customer, but in ITC it was lost. So it affects his thinking, it affects his ability to influence the decision, it affects his ability to get a budget. So please understand the customer's business. And you know, typically that involves some domain knowledge. You must understand the domain in which he's operating. Then there's the issue of mapping the account. You know, not only the business as a whole, but that organization. You must know whom you're talking to. Not just his designation, but what is his role? What is his authority? And, you know, various things that you're looking at.
is whom does he report to? Where does he fit in the overall structure? And then you must understand, what is he a decision maker, or is he just going to recommend something? He's recommending, and the decision is actually taking somewhere else. What is the decision process that they go through for something of this type? Typically, large organizations will involve multiple people. One department or one individual is not going to decide. Multiple people's opinions are going to be taken. You must know who those people are, what their roles are, what their relationships are. Do they get along with each other? Do they not get along with each other? And which is why I think the point that Shankar made, that you must have a coach, somebody there who believes in you, whom you have developed a rapport with, who's willing to share with you, he becomes your inside salesman. And he can, you know, bat for you, he can give you information, because information is the key thing. In fact, I mean, that's another point that I think is very often missed in most organizations started by technologists. They think sales is a lot of fast talk. And to my view, having spent a lifetime doing selling at various levels, is that selling is a very cerebral activity. It's very cerebral. You have to think, what is it about my organization or about my offering that will appeal to the customer? How will it benefit him? How does it relate to his business? And you have to think all of this through. It doesn't take an extrovert to be a good salesperson. You can be an introvert, a very quiet person, and you can be a very good salesperson. So it's a very cerebral activity. You must know what time frame the decision is going to be taken. If you know he wants to just generally look at cloud computing or whatever, you know, he's looking at your offering, but he might take a decision 2 years from now. You might decide not to spend all that effort. So find out as much as you can about that division, that organization, where this fits in, and so on. Map the individuals, find out their relationships, and so on. And you know, there are many such things, but one other important area which I think is very often lost sight of, you know what you're offering, but you have no idea what are the other options that he's looking at. You can be sure that if it's a large deal and it's a large organization, there will be other people knocking at his door, trying to sell him something, competing with you, competing for that same budget. Now, who are they? You'd be surprised. If you have developed a rapport, you can ask him, which are the other options you're looking at? Are you looking at IBM? Are you looking at, you know, who else? How long have they been doing it? You know, very often in sales, you go in early and you influence his requirements, emphasizing those points which are your strong points if you get in early. And obviously you must do that if you get in early. But if somebody else has got in early and he has influenced it, emphasizing those points that are his strengths, then you have a tougher job ahead of you. So clearly you must know. And you must know, sometimes you don't know which offering he has put, you know which competitor, but what is the offering? And then you can find out what are the features of that, you do your research, find out what are the weaknesses of that, what are the strengths of that, and then you fight on those areas where your product is strong or your offering is strong, and try to see how you can address those areas where you're weak relative to the competition. But you must know what the competition is. And it's certainly possible, and it's absolutely essential in a complex sale. In a small sale or initial sale, you might well get by not knowing this. But in a more complex sale, I think you have really no option at all. And obviously, you must also find out how happy is the competitor already there with some different offering. He's probably got an existing relationship. Is he happy with that customer? If he's happy, then you know, obviously it's tougher for you. If he's unhappy, that's good for you. So with that, I think I'll stop. My time is up. I'd like to hand it over to the next speaker, to Ranjan.
Thank you, Anil. Thanks, Shankar. We are running out of time a little. So the next part, actually, we would just be focusing on. Where is it? And thanks for setting the platform. As I understood, most of you are entrepreneurs and you come across competition who are bigger in size. Is that right? Yeah. Most of the times. Yeah. So that's what I wanted to cover, not the perspective from what I had experienced when I was in Oracle, rather what it was when I was in iFlex 13 years back. And the other perspective is, it's for the international market. Indian market you're very familiar with. Most of the aspects that Anil and Shankar talked about in the before me is applicable to India, applicable internationally as well. But I'll just focus a little more on the international market. First, what do you need to do? You might be small, but you can act big. How do you act big? I am actually, this has always been a pricing. More often than not, when somebody asks, what exactly is the price for your solution? We Indians, you know, these are the parameters, it depends on these other factors and so on and so forth. We tend to get into a lot of verbose explanation. Actually, we should not falter in saying this is the price. I'll tell you of an incident. In iFlex, Chairman Rajesh Uku, and we have Raman also, the CEO out here, was narrating the story. At one of the large accounts that iFlex had won, the license pricing was still not fixed up. And there was a gentleman who was heading marketing and sales. He used to be a man of very few words. So when the customer asked, what is the price? He said 7 million. So Rajesh Uku actually kicked him under the table. That's what he said. And later on he was saying, we had never even discussed a pricing like that, and he was out there making me lose the order. But actually they got the order. Because that is a perception that you create with your prospects and customers. That you are sure of what you're selling, you know what you're selling, so price is important. Don't be apologetic about the price. Second, licensing. Many times what happens is, typically in the growing phases, just to get a customer, invariably they will say, do I have enterprise license? Can I use as many seats as possible? You've come across situations like that? Yeah, so what typically happens, and in our eagerness to sell, we actually give it practically free. When you have a product, when you have a license, don't let go the future revenues. Put in a matrix, put in a restriction. So that's why I said limit the capacity. Ask him what he is using for, what is the present usage, and limit him there. Because when he grows, you're also going to make money. Don't let that opportunity go by. Third, many of you would have been in the business for the last 3 years or less. Is that a right assumption? Yeah. Many a times you come across a situation where they're going to ask you your financial balance sheet for the last 3 years, 5 years, and so on and so forth. And you think, these guys I'm competing with have been in the business for the last 10 years. What can I do? Don't be apologetic about it. Instead, show them the product roadmap, that this is what has been my revenue for the last 3 years. This has been the revenue for the last 2 years. This is my product roadmap. This is what I'm going to build into the product. This is what I'm going to localize for your country. This is how I'm serious about your country. This is how I want to invest in your business. More often than not, the IBMs and the Oracles of the world would not be able to show a roadmap. Right, Raman? That's the reality. Because you have US gap, you have all kind of gaps, and they're not able to show the roadmap.
You on both sides, you can
So that is the reality. Now, many times what happens is, the person is buying from you as to not only for his present needs, he feels comfortable that you are going to be there with him, catering to his requirement even in the future. And that is important. And the bigger ones have a disadvantage. Capitalize. So I just touched upon sales plan and financial projections. Financial projections is also, there's no harm coming out with the financial projections. Okay, I don't have a business for the last 10 years. This is what I've done in the next last 3 years, and this is what I'm going to do in the next 5 years. Transparently, you can share with them. There's no harm. And you can also share if you want. If you want to go into the details, my projections last year were so much, and I actually exceeded, or this is what I have done. So that kind of builds up the confidence. Next, put some models in place. You'll come across in any larger organization, they're going to ask you, in case there's a problem, what do I do? Show them a governance model. So you might be five people organization or a 10 people organization, but in all likelihood, you'll have advisors. You'll have advisors like Raman, Anil, who have been advising lots of organizations. Rope them in. And say, in case you have a problem, in case there's escalation, we have our advisors also that you could speak to. I'm just giving an example. It doesn't have to be always that. You can think of ways and means of actually coming up with a governance model. So it's a project that normally you get into. It's just not the off-shelf product that you get into. So there would be problems. And if there is a problem, what is the way of solving it? An escalation model, a governance model, well-drafted, nice PPDs, keep it there with you. Next is, of course, in terms of have your SLAs in place. Don't negotiate. If possible, put up your license agreement. Don't get into the customer's license agreement. The larger organization never get into the customer's license agreement. So why should you? Put it in your terms. Have your own SLAs. The other thing, other aspects is have a knowledge management tool in place, at least even if you don't have it, actually working. Put it up on your website, put it up in your presentation. It actually adds to the professionalism of the organization that you're projecting. So, and of course, in terms of quality, you need to have some certification, some tools, and you have to, the salesperson or the person, if you are going in there, you have to drop in a lot of these names of tools that you use in the organization. The next aspect I'm going to touch upon is a bit on the marketing side. The one I like really is, do all of you, even if you're a small organization, do you use your first name as the first part of your mail ID? Meaning, I am Ranjan Roy. Do I use Ranjan at XYZ? Does anybody do it? Don't do it. Because perception is, this is a small organization. If I just change it to, my name is Ranjan Roy, I change it to Ranjan.Roy, R Roy, at XYZ, immediately the other person is going to perceive that there are too many Ranjans in this organization. So, simple tricks. Try that. Next. You might be the one person support in this whole organization, but put it as support at XYZ. Then sales at XYZ. You might be the person taking up the call, but let it be different IDs. Next. More often than not, in larger organization, what happens is the marketing division would come to the salespeople and say, can you give me a case study? And most of the time, I remember, I'd say, I don't have time. I am busy doing sales. My job is to do sales. If I don't meet the revenue number, Raman is going to pull me up. So I don't have time for that. So they actually don't come out with case studies. Whereas where you people are actually with the customer, aware as to what they are doing, keep putting up case studies. Keep putting up articles. Keep putting up white papers. So that's something you can keep doing. Whenever you have time, just write in a few lines. Put it up on the website. Next is in terms of participate. Today's world is about social media. You have had many sessions, you must have attended many sessions in terms of how social media, how Facebook, how Twitter is actually doing it. whenever you get time, do answer a few queries and put your organization name in there. Somewhere, somehow, your name is going to get searched. Somewhere, the name is going to register in the mind of a prospective customer. I was going to say prospective prospect. Okay. So small little means, but it actually goes in reinforcing the brand of your organization. And finally, that's what they perceive. How you come across your customer and prospect, that's what matters. Did I miss out on anything? Yeah. Rest all, I think most of you are doing it. I just highlighted some of the points which possibly you could do with FAQs, and I'm sure you must be having it. Product literature. If it's a large product, just take out one part. If it's a large application, just take out one part of it and put it up. Let's say if it's a banking application, I might just say how a sweep in account is going to help you. Right? And same way in telecom and so on. So with this, I leave the thoughts to you. Believe me, when in iFlex, when we were a smaller organization, when we had international competition, we didn't have any Indian competition. We actually won, like Anil said, 50% of the deals in the emerging and the developing countries. Thank you very much.
And they followed all your tips, and they went and pitching the same customer. What is that thing that will make one guy win the deal and the other guy lose the deal?
It's obviously very difficult, but I think if somebody is following all of these, first of all, I think he stands a very good chance of winning. And if both of them are following all of these, I would say it is the person who manages to establish rapport with the customer. You know, the first thing that you do is establish people buy from people. They don't buy from businesses. That's why that individual credibility, that individual rapport, that developing some kind of a working relationship, the trust. You know, you buy from somebody who you can trust. You're not going to, you know, put your future and your next year's increment and promotions in the hand of somebody who will let you down. So it's really the rapport and the trust that you build.
Okay, we'll go to the people.
A lot of the points I saw in there coming from kind of a large enterprise background, I could relate to that. But having started a new company just 6 months ago, I couldn't relate to a lot of those because this still seems like it starts from the point that you have some sort of infrastructure, some sort of separate than the last slide that you covered. And then, so the questions that I have in mind are, okay, if I'm signing into bank committee, for example, I can get into the contacts, etc. I have a product which they don't think they need right now. So the complex sales cycle becomes even more complex because there is education required over a period of time. So how do you kind of go jumping various groups? Because the first point of contact may not even think it's useful, and that may be your only point of contact in that organization. But from an outsider's perspective, obviously, when you're passionate about your product, you can see how your product could be very useful within that environment. But how do you start jumping various tools from that point on when your first point of contact says, well, not really?
Is this working?
Yeah, it is.
So I'll probably try and attempt to use some of the points which were presented by all of us. So the first attempt by from my side would be to understand the target market. So I would go about trying to identify if it's a financial offering, right? I would define which is the segment of the bank which I would want to go. And do a bit of a filtering there and say I'm only going to go after this initial file. Having done that, in the process I would have identified what is the specific pain area and why do you want to go after that bank. Maybe the technology has been there for 5 years and it is time for a refresh 2 years later and so on. And that whole process of trying to identify, qualify, and then define the need is going to be a pretty long one.
So for sure, you have to be prepared to wait for that long duration of, you know, need identification and building the whole system so that you are able to convince him on the need, not only that he has to go for it, but also that he has to budget for it in the next financial year. And a lot of your effort will go in there. And pretty much what happens after the budget is defined is you know, go through the flow emotions in terms of the RFP, make sure we have your competition covered. I mean, you basically define in some stages if you are successful, please send it out to these companies. Right? You can also identify who is the competition that you would like to compete and make sure you win. So the earlier you are in the game, the more is your influence on that particular opportunity. And you'll always have to find, in those cases, your best bet is on identifying the coach who is preferably also the economic buyer, what they call it, the person who signs the check. If he is able to coach you and you can, you would not want to start at a managerial level at this kind of situation.
We're going to take 3-4 questions, it's not a problem.
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah. I have a question for Ranjan on the pricing part. You said that when customer asks about the pricing, you say, mention the price of your product that you sell. Now, when we are targeting to a medium-sized company or a small-sized company, they are pretty much price conscious. And obviously, the first question for them is, what is your budget? What is your cost of the product? Now, when I say, specifically I say that it's cost so-and-so, and there could be a chance that we're talking about the product, they may say that I think this price high, and I don't want to look into that. Now, in those scenarios, how do you, treat those situations, and how do we go about it, please?
Thanks.
Let me be there. Sorry.
Can I have a crack at it? You know, very often a customer or a prospect will ask you the price early on. And if I will certainly try to avoid giving him a price to begin with, because it distracts from your sale and takes the focus onto the price. See, the price is always in relationship to value. I remember seeing a sales film. They said, will you buy what's in this box? Will you pay $10,000 for it? $5,000? And you know, you said, no. And then they open the box. It's a fabulous diamond worth $50,000. The price is only in relationship to the value. Until you built up the value, explained the product, demonstrated it, the price is then to be looked at after. But if you start with price, you're changing the focus on price and not on the value. I don't know, Ranjan, if I...
Yeah, Anil, very well said. I mean, definitely, first meeting, please don't discuss the price. The only other aspect I want to add to what Anil said is, only in government meeting where there's an L1, you would lose on price. Never in my experience of 18 years has anybody lost or have come across a situation where if they like the product, you have lost it on price. Unless it's a government bill.
I think what he said previously in the slide was, don't feel shy about telling the price. It is not like the first thing you talk about is price.
That's right.
And what, in case you are asked about the price, what you can also choose to do is not necessarily give them a price, but you could talk about the different models of pricing. You could say that there are different types of engagements you could have. It could be a perpetual license, it could be a term license, it could, you know, and throw more options so that the question becomes relevant.
Actually, I'll slightly make it complicated. Just like how you are qualifying a customer is also qualifying a vendor. In that context, if I'm trying, let's say I have 10,000 rupees in my pocket, I can buy a Titan watch, I can't buy a Rolodex. Right, because it costs 35,000 rupees. So in that qualification process, customers might want to try to find a price from you. Does it fit in my ballpark? How do you tackle that question? Is that somewhat relevant? Okay.
I think it's okay to indicate a range. In fact, it's perhaps a lead-in. It says, what is your budget? What sort of range of budget do you have in mind? Ultimately, that's something that you want to know. So it's you turn the question around.
Yeah.
And try to find out information that otherwise is very difficult to find out.
Exactly.
And if you really are pushed to it, indicate some sort of a range, and the best answer is, in that case, the dependence answer. It depends on what we look at these, we evaluate what exactly your requirements are. Depends on the volume, it depends on the support levels and things of that type. We'll come back to it. Let's first talk about what your needs are. And we'll address those needs, and then the price will depend upon it. The dependence answer.
Sorry, I'm interjecting. There's an anecdotal point I wanted to say. Most often we ask the customer about budget, mostly they will not try to say.
Right.
But actually, smart sales guy will know how to get it. You would simply ask the question, are you talking about $10,000, 1 lakh, 10 lakh? Tell me that. If you ask something like that, customer will say, no, I'm looking at like 1 lakh, not 10,000. But that's a tricky way to get it. Okay,
yeah, my follow-up question was like that. To get to know the budget is very difficult, especially in India. It's very difficult for, they don't tell what is that they have. So in your experience, however, even in large teams, we find it very difficult for them to even give, although they may not have any clear budget. And have you influenced creating budgets in the next cycles in your past experience? How do you do that?
It's
any of you?
So, the first part of the question was influencing the process. Right? You could always, if somebody is asking you about a price, mind you, the question is asked whether you're a small company, startup, or you've been there for a long time. The question is asked to every damn company over there. And if I were a small company and I know there is a credible player better than us in that space, I would say that if you're talking about, you know, using that as an other option, they're probably in the range of $10 million, and I'm sure I'm here better than that in terms of value and price. So you peg against that, but you just position yourself as being better value, better in terms of value and price. You don't need to put a number on the table. But if he says, no, I'm not looking at that and something else model, then you know at least you've got to come down. It just gives you a benchmark. And typically what happens is, as you start engaging and the customer is convinced on the value, they would start talking to you about, this is my budget, you fit in my budget or you don't. And at that point of time, you would start finding means and ways of slicing and dicing the scope, you know, the terms in terms of licensing and all of that to say, let's go with this now and then run and test upon future growth. So you say that I will scale as your business grows. Put your skin in the game, and that would help the customer feel that it's a little bit of a de-risk in that sense.
Yeah, I agree, and I've tried to answer the earlier question also, which was in terms of, we are all selling, most of us are selling business application or business products, right? And you can actually partition the usage or the functionality and so on and so forth. In case you perceive you might be outside the budget, that's why I said have a usage matrix, whereby you get certain functionality data, or he get certain usage data, so have the matrix in place and use that to fit into the budget that you perceive he has.
Last two questions.
Can I just add on?
Raman wants to say something.
It's possible also to use the price to get some idea of the budget.
Yeah.
You know,
that's a very nice.
You want to get some idea. Are you really wanting to spend that kind of time and putting those resources? So you say, you know, our product and offering will cost so much, roughly this sort of range. Is that okay with you? And look him in the eye.
Yeah. If you're right in front of him,
look him in the eye and see his reaction. Does he have the money or not? You very often find it.
Find it, exactly.
So,
if your coach hasn't told you the budget already, he is the guy to get the budget from.
Sometimes we get misled that this is the coach, but actually, they are the coach.
Can I just add something? This is a very, very complex area. In fact, you know, many a times even the customer may not have a very fixed budget, you know, because if you're talking about enterprise sale, you know, you're talking about ERP application or a core banking or something like that, it's very complex. And in fact, there are lots of ways and means by which you really gather intelligence, okay? For example, Ramyan mentioned about we quoted a $7 billion license. Ultimately, we sold it for $14 million. Okay, and then we said, then the customer said, okay, what if I want a source code? We said, no, you have to then pay another $10 million. So it became a $25 million license sale. But really, you know, we figured out later that, you know, the problem that we were trying to solve was to replace a legacy application, which was running in some 50 countries and so on and so forth. And a simple piece of information that we had to get was how much they were spending on the current application. You know, put all the hardware and the software and maintenance and all of that stuff. After paying the $25 million license and implementation and maintenance to us, from what we quoted, the bank was still saving $100 million every year. The whole project was funding by retiring what they were actually spending on it. That is a piece of information that we had to gather in our sales process. It is not about, and then you say the value that you're able to bring, not only you're retiring, you're bringing more modern application, you're saving the bank $100 million in the process, plus he can double his business. He can expand his customer base to twice what he has got today. So really, this is very complex. The other thing in a complex, very complex sale is that I think most of us suffer from it, and including iFlex, we learned the hard way during the initial days. If you're responding to an RFP, you have already lost the battle, or half the battle is lost. You have to be really, you know, understanding the need, creating the need, or, you know, having the complete handle on what the problem the customer is trying to solve and engage even prior to the RFP coming out, you know, so that really you're in a position to influence the RFP, and that's how you actually eliminate your competition, and not by reducing your price, because that game is dangerous. Then the moment you have done the first few sales, then the subsequent customers, it's all, you know, everybody knows everybody in this, in the marketplace. You can never go up, and you can never, you know, increase your price. So really you try to figure out, okay, what is it that, you know, you can influence, how you can better understand the customer needs, and that you can do by actually, you know, going well ahead in the sales process before.
He's asking, you guys are talking about sales coach. How do you, the whole conversation somehow is sort of centered around the sales coach understanding how to do all. So how do you identify the best or the correct sales coach? Is Anil probably for you?
Well, you know, ideally, it's somebody who is respected in the organization, who typically will not be the decision maker. He's an influencer. But he likes your offering, likes you, presumably, and what you're saying, and what you say resonates with him. It appeals to him. And then he, in his desire to get your offering or your product, he's coaching you. He's doing it for his interest. So he must be an interested party. That's why he will take the effort to find out and keep on feeding you information and saying good things about you, you know, making out the case. So it's somebody who is affected, who is influential, and with whom you develop rapport. Ideally.
Okay.
With that note,
I'm sorry?
It's taken from two ends.
But you know, he must be in an interested party. Then only can he make the effort. Otherwise, you know, he'll say, look, you know, yes, he'll say something good and then that's it. But it's a continuous long range process over many months. So you have to keep it up.
Okay, with that note, we will end this session.
Thank you.
Yes, please stay back. Actually, one question I wanted to ask, if you didn't ask, is what's happening to buying versus selling in B2B sales? For example, in B2B.